So welcome everyone to our ESA-BJ on Things to Come webinar of today. We have invited Professor Michael Küppers today from the European Space Agency in Villanueva de la Cañada in Spain to give a talk today about the HERA mission of the European Space Agency. You can see him in the camera here, and you can also see Professor Eckhard Kurt also in the camera. He is one of the ESA-BJ discipline scientists, and he will today moderate the talk. Thank you very much to both for accepting our invitation. I am Laura. You might know me from the previous webinars. I'm the PR manager of ISSI-BJ. And before we can start, I can give you a brief introduction to ISSI-BJ, that is the International Space Science Institute Beijing. ISSI-BJ was funded in 2013, thanks to the cooperation between the International Space Science Institute in Switzerland, in Bern, the capital, and the National Space Science Center of the Chinese Academy of Sciences here in Beijing. And ISSI in Switzerland, we aim to advance space science studies by promoting and supporting scientists and researchers and experts in different disciplines all pertaining to space science to organize their events and their meetings here at ISSI-BJ at our premises and to carry out the research here and with our support. Before the epidemic, we used to organize different offline meetings, including workshops and forums, and we had international team meetings, working groups. Unfortunately, this is not possible anymore. We hope it will be achievable next year. But in the meanwhile, we have started a couple of webinar series, so online events, including this On Things to Come series. It was started last September 2020, and it aims to introduce ongoing and future space missions to the scientific community. So we invite speakers from JAXA, ESA, NASA, the Chinese Academy of Sciences to talk about the space missions they're working on. The second webinar series we have is in Chinese, and it's called 1001 Space Nights. Again, it's in Chinese, and we invite outstanding Chinese female women scientists to talk about their research and their achievements. We are going to have very, very soon a new webinar series with some young scientists working in our international teams, but the official announcement will come very soon. So without further ado, I would like to ask Professor Kurt, again, our discipline scientist, to give a brief introduction to Professor Küppers, about Professor Küppers, and then we can start. Thank you very much.
Hello, everybody. Also for me, it's my big pleasure to introduce Michael, because I worked with him together for a long time in spoiler body research, and it was always a big pleasure to be together with him. Michael obtained his PhD in 1996 from University in Göttingen in Germany. It's a topic to Jupiter's moon Io and its plasma environment. And then he was working at different universities as a postdoc, e.g. in Boulder, Colorado, or in Bern, Switzerland. But he also made big research at the Max Planck Institute in Göttingen, together with Uwe Keller, the big camera guy. In 2007, Michael joined the European Space Agency, and there he was again active in small body research, and he was a member of big missions like Rosetta or Herschel. And additionally, he started to deal with planetary defense topics and also with impact physics. Currently, Michael is an ESA project scientist of the upcoming ESA mission HERA, and about that he will talk today to us. And additionally, since July 1st, Michael is also the project scientist of the ESA F-class mission Comet Interceptor. I can see he's a big guy in planetary research, and he has published 170 reviewed papers. We are looking forward for your work, Michael. Michael is yours.
So the topic of the mission, as already mentioned by Eckhart in his very nice introduction, is the HERA mission. which together with NASA's DART mission is the first planetary defense demonstration of humankind, so to speak. And in the presentation, I will first a little bit give a background about asteroids' impacts and the potential threat of the impact of an asteroid on Earth and about possible options to avoid it. And then in the second part, I will talk specifically about the various aspects of the HERA mission, of course, the planetary defense, but also about the science that can be done with the HERA mission. So I start with something which you may have heard, which happened a very long time ago, which is the impact in the Gulf of Mexico that happened around 65 million years ago, and where we think today that it is responsible for the extinction of the dinosaurs, not so much the direct impact, but the climatic changes that followed the impact, we think now are responsible there. Now, this is something that's a very long time ago, and actually our idea is that this happened repeatedly in the history of the Earth. So this is the plot of the fraction of species, a percentage of species that was extinct, that became extinct in a certain time period. Here is the impact that we think killed the dinosaurs, and the other points that are indicated here, their connection is not as clear as for the Shih Tzu Club impact, but there we also have the idea that it may be related to impact. So the picture from this is that there is a cataclysmic change of Earth with a complete change of the species, something like once every 100 million years. Now, this is probably not a reason for immediate concern, as the likelihood that we or our children will be affected by that, by such an impact which requires an asteroid of 10 kilometers or so, is extremely unlikely. So we see what damage happens with somewhat smaller objects. An example of a more recent impact is Meteor Crater in Arizona, which is a bit more than a kilometer in diameter. The estimated age is around 50,000 years, so still long ago, but it's a somewhat more frequent event than such a big dinosaur killer. And it probably was an asteroid with a diameter of only 100 or a few hundred meters. One thinks it's a metallic object that created a particularly big crater. Going further to the more recent history, this is an image from the Tunguska area after an impact of a very small object of 50 meters or so destroyed more than 2,000 square kilometers of forest. Not much happened there because it's a sparsely populated area, but in terms of the surface areas that was devastated by this blast, if it happens elsewhere, such an impact could destroy a city, for example. And maybe for us the most present example that such an asteroid impact is a real threat was the explosion of a small object 20 meters or so close to the Russian city of Chelyabinsk in 2013. On the left hand side you can see a video taken by a car camera. Those cameras are often, of course, not to wait for meteorites, but to have evidence in case of an accident. And with this impact, a lot of glass was shattered in the town, and around 1,500 people, if I remember correctly, were injured. So there is some real possibility of damage happening due to an asteroid. And on the right-hand side is a meteorite from that impact that was found after the air blast, and the size for scale, the size of the cube next to it is 1 centimeter cube. Now, taking our knowledge about the nearest asteroids that are next to us, one can get a statistical idea of the danger. So this plot let's concentrate on this lower axis that shows the diameter of the impact, and the right-hand side axis that gives the impact interval when we would statistically, every many years, we would statistically expect such an impact to happen. So as mentioned before, this very huge dinosaur killing impact, it's once every 100 million years or so, so it's a very rare event. Tunguska-sized event is something already more frequent, which happens every 1,000 years or every 700 years or so. And the Chelyabinsk-sized event is once every few years. So it's not a particular immediate event. We don't have to be really afraid that something happens soon. The likelihoods are relatively low, but it's still a threat that we should prepare to avoid if we can. And it turns out that just now we live in a time where we become able to avoid such a disaster through an asteroid impact should it happen. So what can we do against an asteroid impact? How can we try to avert the danger from an asteroid? Well, in a summary, it's as easy as 1, 2, 3. First of all, we have to know the asteroids that may be impacting us. If we don't know them, there's nothing we can do about them. So therefore, we have search programs. For example, this photo is the Pan-STARRS telescope on Hawaii. There are various search programs. And we can see that nowadays a lot of those asteroids are discovered. So this is a discovery history. And basically 30, 40 years ago, barely any new Earth asteroids were known. Nowadays, so the ones that are kilometer size or larger are the dark reds one, and the curve, it's a cumulative curve, so it's a total detected that we see at any time. The red curve is now pretty much flat, which tells us that we know most of the very large asteroids in near Earth space are detected by now, are known by now. The 140 meter that corresponds essentially to an absolute brightness of the asteroid, that it's roughly converted into size. Those are the ones approximately 140 meters or more. If some object of this size would be detected to be on collision course with Earth, we would be doing something about it. As we can see, this curve is still increasing, and estimates are that by now we know about 30 or 50% of those objects maybe. And here the expectation is that with the upcoming surveys, among them the Large Synoptic Surface Telescope and probably the NEO Surface Space Mission, we should be near completion in about 10 years from now. And then there are the very small objects where, of course, without size limit, millions will exist and where we continuously detect them. But the focus currently is on those objects here in the yellow area. Now, once we have discovered the asteroids, we need to be able to follow their orbit, to be able to evaluate if they are in danger, if they may collide with Earth at some point, and if we think they are potentially dangerous, also to characterize them physically. For this, we also have, of course, telescopic observations as examples. Here are images of the ESA optical ground station in Tenerife and of the ESO Very Large Telescope in Chile. The upper one will be most more for the relatively bright objects, the Very Large Telescope for the fainter ones. And I realized that the interactivity for such a virtual talk is somewhat limited. But you can try to find the asteroids moving through the stars in this video of a couple of images. So two of the asteroids should be detectable. There's a third one that one may be able to spot, and a fourth one in this video, which I would say is nearly impossible. So if you see four asteroids here, mention it in the chat. So the first two are up here, and I believe it was possible to see them also without the star, without the arrows. The third one is a bit more difficult. The row will pop up now. It's this object that's relatively slowly moving on the right. And the fourth one, you even with this row, you will have to look very careful to see it. It's a faint thing moving also here relative to the stars. So this is basically the way those are detected in the big surveys. They are normally detected by software, but some are still find by, or even nowadays find by visual inspection of images. Now, once all this is done, and in the case that we find that some object will impact Earth at some point in the future, the next and third step would be to deflect it. So essentially, the principle is the asteroid is on collision course with Earth, and with some technique, one gives it a knob to change its trajectory that it misses Earth. This is the principle of all the methods. And there are currently three methods that are seriously considered in the sense that we may be technologically capable of using them. One is the gravity tractor. The concept is very much straightforward. One puts the spacecraft next to the asteroid, and the gravity of the spacecraft will, of course, attract the asteroid, and this will change its orbit. And if this is done for a long enough time, it will change the orbit enough that an Earth hitting Earth impacting orbit may be changed into an Earth missing orbit. So the advantage is the simplicity. One doesn't need to know that much about the asteroid apart from its mass. The disadvantage is that it's relatively inefficient because for all practical applications, the mass of the spacecraft will be very small compared to the mass of the asteroid. The second technique is a little bit on the other end of the spectrum. It's the nuclear explosion. It's a nuclear generally. It's not blasting the object. In this respect, the image I'm showing here may be a bit misleading. So it's normally a standoff explosion of a nuclear device where the shockwave would push the asteroid away. The advantage is highly efficient, and in the case of a very large object or shorter warning time, it may be actually the only possibility. The disadvantage is that it is so powerful that the outcome of the outcome of the event is difficult to predict. So simply the strength of the wave may also potentially disrupt the object, with the consequences being not clear. There is the other issue of launching a big nuclear device into space, which would be controversial. So there are issues on that side of the story. And the third method, and this is the one we are going to demonstrate, is a kinetic impactor, with the principle essentially to send a spacecraft to impact the asteroid. And the momentum of the impact will change the orbit of the asteroid and also make sure that it misses Earth. This is probably the most advanced method we are going to demonstrate it. By the way, the image here shows the impact of the deep impact spacecraft on Comet Tempel 1. So one can say conceptually it is already demonstrated. And it does, as I will show in a minute, depend on the properties of the asteroid, the outcome of such a technique, which is the motivation of the HERA mission, which I'm going to present in the next part of the presentation. So looking at those deflection methods according to the situation, so everything that's smaller than 50 or 100 meters or so would not go for a mission. It would probably not be practical, and it has to be essentially the action that would be taken would be civil defense, which means evacuation, or depending on the size, also like for smaller objects, also simply like simple things like staying away from windows and so on. Now, once one starts with a deflection mission, the gravity tractor could be an option for relatively small objects and for very long warning times. Otherwise, for not too large objects, the method of choice would be the kinetic impactor, and the nuclear device would be needed for the very large ones. Now, keeping in mind that there are more smaller asteroids than larger ones, the method most likely to be needed, should the case ever occur, would be the kinetic impactor. And actually, the size range we are investigating with DART and HERA, with the in the collaboration of DART and HERA, is exactly in this 100 to 200 meter range. Now, the first asteroid deflection demonstration is the AIDA international collaboration. AIDA stands for Asteroid Impact Deflection Assessment. And it's a cooperation of two missions. First, NASA's DART mission, which I believe was presented in this forum very nicely by Andy Chang about 2 months ago. The DART mission will impact the moon of a binary asteroid. So the binary asteroid is Didymos, its moon is called Dimorphos, and it's kind of a technology demonstration of asteroid deflection on a smaller scale. What that will do, it will impact Dimorphos and will change the orbit of the secondary on the primary. So it will not change the heliocentric orbit, at least not significantly. It will change the orbit of the asteroid moon about the primary asteroid. This has two advantages. The first one is that Didymos is an eclipsing binary, so the orbital period is very well known, and the change of the orbital period that can be observed even from Earth can be created with less momentum, with a smaller impact, than a demonstrable change of the heliocentric orbit of the asteroid. And the second advantage of the setup is, if one would change the heliocentric orbit of an asteroid, it is extremely difficult to demonstrate that, even going into the far future, to exclude that this change could at one point in the far future make the asteroid impact. Those are the two advantages of changing the orbit of the moon, that one can exclude causing any trouble for the future, and the second thing is that one can demonstrate the technique with a smaller mission, essentially. So that will hit Dimorphos. That will take a small CubeSat with it, Ligia tube, light Italian CubeSat for imaging of asteroid, provided by ASI, by the Italian Space Agency. And essentially, the CubeSat will, a few minutes after the DART impact, will fly by the asteroid and look at the ejecta, and also on the crater, in case the crater is visible and not obscured by the ejector. Then, a couple of years later, HERA comes in, and HERA will investigate both asteroids and essentially will look in detail at the outcome of the impact and, of course, investigate the double asteroid. And HERA also will take two CubeSat with it, Milani and Juventus, that will be operating autonomously in the asteroid system. Okay, as DART has already been presented in a month on Things to Come seminar, only just a quick slide on Didymos and one slide on DART. So the binary Didymos is the primary. Is about 800 meters in diameter, the secondary around 160 meters, so just the size range that is probably most relevant for planetary defense. They are a bit more than a kilometer apart. And actually, we have a rough shape model already for the primary from radar data during a close approach with Earth in 2003. So that changes the orbit. And just a few facts about that. It's supposed to impact end of September, early October next year. Launch will be, the launch window opens 24th of November this year. It's, as mentioned, a kinetic impactor. Those numbers are approximate. It's a bit more than 600 kilometers and 6.6 kilometers per second, a bit depending on the actual launch date. So it will change the orbital period. The period change will be measured from Earth. That takes advantage of a close approach, relatively close approach to Earth of Didymos of 0.07 AU, which is roughly 10 or 12 million kilometers. And another notable fact is that the primary is a fast rotator with a spin period of a little bit more than 2 hours, while the orbital period of Dimorphos is around 12 hours. We don't know the spin period, but we expect it to be locked so that the spin period is the same as the orbital period. So an overview of the HERA mission. HERA is foreseen to be launched in autumn 2024. The cruise to Didymos will take a little bit more than 2 years, which is, it's not in the graph here. There will be a Mars flyby during the cruise. And we are also investigating the possibility to fly by a small asteroid on the way to Didymos, more probably a small asteroid in the inner main belt. Arrival is end of 26, early 2027. And the way to investigate the asteroid follows pretty much the heritage we're having from Rosetta. So there will first be a phase at a relatively large distance from the asteroid, 20, 30 kilometers, for the global characterization of the shape, the mass, and also get some idea of the system dynamics. After that, the two CubeSats, are small, 30 times 20 times 10 centimeter spacecraft that will then from that point on do their own investigations of the asteroid. Then HERA itself goes into the detail characterization phase. It goes into 10 kilometers for the global mapping of both objects. We will get the multi-point investigations with the three spacecraft, including the inter-satellite link that will allow for high accuracy radio science. The CubeSat radar will investigate the subsurface of both asteroids and the interior of the smaller one. And then HERA itself also will get closer and closer to the asteroids with increased spacecraft autonomy, especially to investigate the dark impact crater with large detail and any other interesting points that may be on the asteroid. The end of the mission is tentatively landing of all three spacecraft, landing of HERA itself on the primary, and landing of the two CubeSats on the Dimorphos on the moon of the asteroid. So, given that DART will measure, DART will do the impact, and the ground-based observers will measure the orbit change and therefore the deflection of the asteroid, what are the main goals of HERA after this is done? One is, and to understand one point, it's important to look a little bit into what happens in the impact, into the momentum transfer. If the spacecraft and the asteroid were billiard balls, it would be easy. The incoming momentum of the spacecraft, so the mass times the velocity of DART, would be transferred to the asteroid, which is then the asteroid mass times the velocity change. The velocity change is measured by the ground-based observers, and the ratio of the velocity change and the incoming momentum would be the mass of the Dimorphos. But for an asteroid, it's more complex because what will happen at the impact is that the crater is created on the Dimorphos, and the reaction force of the ejector from the crater creates an additional momentum. So the momentum transferred to the asteroid is the momentum of the incoming spacecraft plus the momentum coming from the reaction force of the ejector, which we normally expresses with the momentum transfer efficiency beta, which is defined essentially as a ratio of the momentum transferred to the asteroid divided by the incoming momentum. So if there's no crater, if only the spacecraft momentum is transferred, beta would be 1. And if the impact, if the effect of the crater is the same, it is as large as the one of the incoming spacecraft, it would be 2, for example. So with this, we have two unknowns in the momentum equation, the mass of the morphos and the beta factor. And to understand how efficient the impact is, we essentially need to measure the mass of the morphos, which is one of the goals of HERA. The way this will be done is by measuring the wobble motion of Didymos due to the motion of both objects around the cone center of mass. We have done some simulations of this, and we expect that we will be able to get the mass of the moon in this way to an accuracy of a few percent. And this will be supported by using the radio signs, essentially by the spacecraft deflection due to the gravity of the morphos, which is kind of the classical mass determination in space missions. But in this case, this is complicated due to the presence of the much more massive primary only a kilometer away from the morphos. So the main method in this case, we expect to be the wobble measurement. Then the second point is to get the detailed dynamics of the Didymos system. What I presented before about the momentum transfer is a little bit simplified because it's expected that the impact is not exactly central on the asteroid and that some torque will exert it on the moon, which can create all kind of secondary dynamical effects in addition to the in addition to the velocity change. One of those are librations, which is essentially a deviation of the log rotation. This is illustrated here on the left hand side with the libration of the moon. This is essentially the moon seeing from Earth integrated over a month, and we can see this that the Earth facing side of the moon essentially slightly changes over time. This is the libration. This has been modeled by now what would be expected from a dart impact, and depending on the parameters, a libration could be imposed of several degrees and also some probably minor variations of the orbital parameters in addition to the separation that will change with the impact, also inclination and eccentricity maybe somewhat affected, also the effect is small in the models we are currently having. So one, the second goal of the HERA mission is to accurately measure those dynamic effects due to the 6 months of long-term measurements while at the asteroid. The third goal from HERA is actually to measure the properties of the morphos to be able to scale the impact results to other objects. And I'll show two illustrative examples why this is important. The first property, which we think is important here, is porosity. This plot essentially shows the momentum transfer enhancement factor, the momentum transfer efficiency, as a function of porosity. And what we can see is that for very solid bodies, for bodies of very low porosity, the momentum transfer through the ejector, so the reaction force of the ejector, can be even larger than the direct impact, which is just one. While for a large porosity, it is negligible. And so the physical reason for this is that at large porosity, much of the energy of the incoming projectile goes into compression of the target and not so much into creating a crater and into creating ejector. Therefore, there are few ejector and therefore little enhancement of the momentum transfer. So this is one important property to be able to scale the impact, also to understand the physics. The second example is the strength of the target. So here, this plot shows the impact diameter, the crater diameter as a function of the impactor diameter for different values of strength. And the very upper curve here is from experiments from impact into water. The strength less, so only gravity essentially keeps the crater from growing. And the other curves are for different versions of strength. And one can see the crater size can vary by more than an order of magnitude, and then again, accordingly, the amount of ejecta will vary, and with this, also the enhancement of the momentum. And finally, the goal is to really get the detailed images, detailed idea of what the crater looked like, so the shape and the volume of the impact. And also, the crater gives a unique opportunity to look into the meteorite analog of the asteroid. As the crater creates a fresh surface, it is expected to look much more similar to the meteoritic analog than the bulk surface of the asteroid. So the images and spectra of the crater are also important to understand the impact. And also, the morphology of the crater will tell us essentially in which kind of material the impact happened, which is also again important for the scaling of the impact and for the understanding of the physical process of the essentially of the impact process of the spacecraft into the target object. So just a quick introduction of the payload that HERA will use to investigate the asteroid. So the main workhorse, both for navigation and for science, are the asteroid framing cameras. It's a broadband panchromatic imager in the visible range with a bit more than 5 degrees field of view and a resolution of 1 meter per pixel from 10 kilometers of the object. For the determination of the detailed shape and the geophysics, the imager is supported by a small laser rangefinder, the planetary altimeter. It can work at a very high operations frequency. The footprint is much larger than the field of view of the camera, and it's again both for navigation to measure the distance to the object and to support the science and the asteroid deflection goals by the distance distribution over its field of view to contribute to an accurate 3D shape. Then the Japanese space agency JAXA is contributing the thermal infrared image on HERA. It's a further development of the thermal infrared image on Hayabusa 2, with the difference is that a larger detector is used with a larger field of view. And some spectral element was added. It has 6 filters covering the range from 7 to 40 micron for the thermal and physical properties of the asteroid. Then for the spectral information in the visible near infrared region, we have the hyperspectral imager. It's the Hyperscout H. It's based on the Hyperscout instrument that is actually flying on Earth observations missions on CubeSats. It has a large field of view. The pixel resolution is comparable to the camera, slightly less. And it's equipped with a mosaic filter, which essentially are filters that are directly fixed on the detector. So the detector is made up of a set essentially of 5x5 pixel mosaics, which a filter on each pixel is called a mosaic filter. It covers the range from 660 to 975 nanometers. So it gets, assuming the cell, the Didymos is an S type, and assuming the same holds for the moon, we get some of the linear increase in the visible and then the left hand side of the 1 micron absorption filter with this instrument. Of the 1 micron absorption line with this instrument. And it's actually the first time that such a kind of filter is flown in planetary science. Then we have the 2 CubeSats on HERA. So the first CubeSat is Milani. It carries another visible near infrared spectrometer. It's a Fabry Pro that covers a wide range from 0.5 micron to 2.5 micron with a spectral resolution of 20 to 40 nanometers. In addition, we have a thermogravimeter to detect and analyze the composition of any dust that may be in the asteroid environment. Furthermore, the second CubeSat has a low frequency radar. It's actually the first in situ radar measurement of an asteroid. It operates at a frequency of around 60 megahertz, which corresponds to a wavelength of 5 meters roughly. We hope that it may be able to investigate, it's a monostatic radar, and we hope that it may be able to investigate the full secondary object for the binary. It will get subsurface information with a radar resolution, which is sometimes a bit difficult to define, of 10 meters or so. In addition, for the cubes that land up, it takes a gravimeter for the landing. This, the cubes that takes a gravimeter to measure accurately the gravity of the morphos at landing, which gives some information of the mass and also the mass distribution. And finally, we have a radio science experiment on board, which in addition to the usual radio science, the measurement essentially of the acceleration of the spacecraft by the asteroid from the Earth ground radio link, it will also take advantage of the internet satellite link between HERA and the CubeSat, and from this we hope for substantial increase in the accuracy of the radio science. Coming now to the science aspects on HERA, where HERA is essentially the planetary defense mission due to it being the first mission to a binary asteroid and also to the first mission to an asteroid of a size of the size range, it also has substantial science value. And starting a little bit from the general background, just to note that collisions play a large role in the formation and evolution of the solar system. It starts with the planetesimal formation from essentially collision of dust and then boulder-sized objects, up to the accretion into planets. The solar system has throughout been shaped by impacts, by giant in its early phases, by giant impacts like the moon forming impacts, where we nowadays think that a Mars-sized object hits the moons. And then the small bodies, which are the asteroids and comets, which are the leftovers of the production phase, essentially of the phase where the planets form from planetesimals. They are the leftovers, they give us some information about those early phases, and then they inform us about the late phase where the asteroids, through collision and through other physical effects, got disrupted again and formed the asteroid families and the asteroid populations that we see nowadays. So which role plays Didymos and play HERA there? Now, for the first time, we can look clearly in detail on a binary asteroid. Down here are two other examples of binary asteroids that have been observed by Earth-based radar. But we will get the first detailed imaging, or the first detailed rendezvous with a binary asteroid. Sorry, Galileo already flew by asteroid Ida and imaged it with its moon, but the first detailed investigation of a binary asteroid is HERA. One thing to note is binaries are relatively frequent. It's estimated that 15% of near-Earth asteroids are binary objects. The idea of the creation of those binaries is that it happens with a so-called YORB effect, which is essentially a speed-up due to the torque by non-isotropic thermal re-radiation of sunlight that comes in. So there are two effects. One is the Yarkovsky effect, which is a change in the orbit of the asteroid, and the change which is the momentum that is transferred, and the torque transfer can lead to speed up and to disruption of objects. This is our main idea how those asteroids are formed. There are also some other ideas. Some think that this can be a direct consequence of an impact. And so these questions will be hopefully answered by looking at the structure, especially of the interstellar structure of those asteroids, to see that they are made up of the same, which is expected, that they are coming from the same object. Also to see if they are rubble piles or if the smaller one may be a more solid object. Those questions help us, those investigations help us to say how binaries are formed. The other aspect is that Didymos rotates very quickly, and it is the first asteroid that is visited near the disruption limit, with its rotation period of a little bit more than 2 hours. The other thing is the size range of the morphos of the moon, which is not only interesting for planetary defense, but also for science. So what we see here is the essentially depending on the spin periods of asteroids, depending on its size. And one can see that very fast rotators are always small. And the idea is that those asteroids have some material strength that keeps them together, that avoids disruption if they speed up, while the larger ones are held together by gravity only. So if they would speed up further, they would be disrupted through the centrifugal force. And with the morphos, we will, for the first time, visit an asteroid that is in this transition range from the gravity and strength regime and may have completely different physical properties from the asteroids that we have seen so far that have always been in the gravity regime or in the transition region here. Here's again, it's shown for comparison, the radar-based shape model of Didymos compared to Bennu and Bugu that have been visited by Osiris Rex and Hayabusa. Another interesting point is the cratering physics here. The one of the surprises of Hayabusa 2 was that the crater was about the size of the crater of the small carry-on impactor. So Hayabusa 2 threw a small projectile with a velocity of 2 kilometers per second on the asteroid, and the crater was a factor of a few larger than would have been expected. And this can only be explained if even at this 10 meter scale or so, there was no notable strength and the crater was limited by gravity. Now, we would have expected before this that at such a small object as Dimorphos with the dark impact, it would be strength limited. And this goes into the current estimates of a 5 or 10 meter sized crater. Now, after the surprise from Hayabusa 2, it's interesting to see what will happen. It opens for the dark crater kind of a new parameter range that may be explored by this impact. And this adds to the, this means that we may see much more than the crater itself. Things that one can speculate about is that a large impact may create an antipodal crater, cracks, ejector range, general up to global surface, resurfacing of the surface. So we may be seeing much more than the crater from the dark impact. We may really see the asteroid change in the more extreme case that this change that really strength is so extremely low on these asteroids that even a 150 meter body is dominated by how it's kept together by gravity and not by its strength. This is another, we see here with the Saturn moons, Atlas and Pan, some of those features that I mentioned in a completely different size regime for illustration. So we are open to seeing many features, many new features, many surprising features on the object that will tell us a lot about the makeup and the physics of those asteroidal bodies. I think I have to speed up. I'm afraid I'm already beyond my 40 minutes. So, the spacecraft is let's say medium-sized. It will be around 1,100 kilos, a bit more in the case of a backup launch. We have a backup launch window in 26, which is requires a larger cruise to asteroids. So the main nominal mission is launching in 24, arriving in 26, 27. The backup mission launches in 26 and would arrive late 2030, early 21. The spacecraft uses chemical propulsion. It's three stable, axis stabilized. And both the cameras and the laser will be used for both for science and for navigation. It has a fixed high-gain antenna and around 30 meters of solar panels to get the 1,000 watts of power that the spacecraft needs. Here in the middle picture, one can see the payload deck with the two CubeSat deployers and with the instrumentations. Just 1 minute at the end about the HERA science team organization. So HERA is not a PI mission. Most of the instruments are industrial procurements, and the science team is organized really as an overall mission science team, which means that we have a HERA investigation team consisting of the mission PI, who is Patrick Michel from Observatoire de Côte d'Azur, the instrument lead, so the specialist for the different instruments, the HERA international team members. We have invited members from the DART, Hayabusa 2, OSIRIS-REx and DART teams in, with their experience to help us with the organization of the HERA mission and with the analysis of the HERA mission, and of the chairs of the four HERA science working groups, which I'll show on the next slide. The whole thing is coordinated by our science management board, which is again Patrick as mission PI. We have four mission advisors, and I'm also in there as an ESA project scientist. The actual work is organized in the four science working group plus a close operations planning group that is chaired by my colleague Richard Meusel here at ESA. I won't read out all the names of the working group chairs of the international HERA team to you, just to say the HERA working groups are open. If anyone listening here would like to contribute to the mission, just send me an email. So in summary, HERA is a mission of first. There are several things that will be done for the first time. It's the first precise measurement of deflection efficiency, and together with DART, it's the first demonstration of our capability to deviate an asteroid should it be necessary one day. It's the first rendezvous mission with a binary asteroid. It's also the first detailed measurement of the small body cratering physics, the first time where we investigate in detail a crater where we exactly know the properties of the impactor. And it's the first time that CubeSats will autonomously operate around an object in deep space. And it's also the first internal structure probing of an asteroid with radar. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. I'm actually relieved that you're still there, the way this worked.
Perfect. There are some questions. If Professor Kurt, I think in the chat box there are three questions already.
Yes, I can see some questions here, Michael. I start with the first one. Would the thickness of the regolith have effect on the impact process and momentum transfer efficiency? The thickness of regolith is the issue.
Yes, it's indeed, it is an issue in the sense that it depends a little bit how the thing is made up. But if one has, for example, a softer regolith layer above a harder layer below it, the crater and the amount of ejecta would be larger in the regolith than in the harder part. And so the momentum efficiency would be the larger, the thicker the regolith layer is. So it is, okay. It is important to essentially the strength of the material.
Exactly. Very good question. Next question. Could Didymos have spun faster than 2.26 hours?
This depends about the assumptions of its properties, again with the strengths being important. So Zhenqiang has done some modeling. There was a video of that in one of the view graphs. There is some part in parameter space where Didymos is very close to its eruption limit and may already be shedding some material. Also, the most likely scenario is probably that it is that it could still rotate somewhat faster and is not yet just at the disruption limit, but we don't know for sure.
Okay. What is the percentage of binary asteroids in the whole near-Earth asteroid population? You know that?
From what we know, it's around 15%. So it's 15. quite substantial, 15.
Yeah, it's a lot. Mm-hmm.
It's quite a lot, yes.
Next question. Originally, it was planned to send Impactor DART by NASA and spacecraft HERA by ESA together to the asteroid. Later, HERA was postponed. Has this any effect on the outcome, scientific outcome of the HERA mission?
Yes, it is indeed true. HERA was originally foreseen to be launched in 2020, but after it didn't get full funding at ESA's ministerial in 2016, when it then got the funding finally in 2019, it was too late to make the 2020 launch date, and it was decided to have HERA arrive 4 years later. Now, most of the science goals can still be, of the deflection goals, that they can still be reached, as once the impact has happened on an asteroid, not much changes in 4 years. And it may even be the advantage that one can be really sure to see the final state after the time. The one thing that is lost by not being there during the impact, that we will not see the ejector from the impact and the development of the ejector. And this is one of the reasons that the Italian CubeSat has been added to DART, that with its flyby after the impact, it will be able to at least partially recover the knowledge of the ejector that we are now missing by HERA not being there simultaneously with DART.
Okay, next question. What is the advantage of having selected a binary asteroid for the experiment? Is it not too complex to analyze?
Very good question. It's actually true that it's a little bit more complex to analyze. The two advantages of choosing a binary asteroid is it's easier to demonstrate that one has indeed changed the orbit of a secondary around a binary than to demonstrate the change of the heliocentric orbit of a target. So one can use the technology demonstration with a smaller mission than would be needed to really change to make a big change of the heliocentric orbit. The second thing is if one would use a bigger mission, one just hits an asteroid and changes its heliocentric orbit, it is difficult to prove that this impact may not make this object hit Earth in some distant future. And this difficulty could cause some issues for the mission that may be more psychological than real, but they still may be there. These are the two reasons to try this deflection demonstration mission on a binary. It is correct that this adds a little bit of complication on the further analysis. I mean, the change in the orbit is particularly easy to show in this case, but the further analysis is a little bit complicated. This is indeed true, but we are confident that we have this under control.
I'm sure that you will do so. This was the last question in the chat box. Let me ask a question. At the end, I am a little bit familiar with impact physics, and a big issue in such an impactor and a kinetic impactor is an unknown impact momentum transfer efficiency. By the ejector, additional impact transfer can be caused, so-called momentum multiplying, but this also strongly depends on material properties like strength or regolith, whatever. And how representative will the outcome of the HERA mission be for other problems? Because this beta parameter is largely unknown and can change from target to target.
Yes. So that's a good question. So we will measure the impact efficiency for the bad impact with HERA or with the support of HERA. And then the transfer to another object is not trivial. I fully agree with that. So what we will try is to measure the, let's say, to measure the properties from HERA that go with this, essentially that go with this impact efficiency, and to see if it is possible to scale this to another asteroid. So actually, for the far future, in the original planet, ESA's original planetary defense roadmap, after HERA, it was foreseen to have a series of small spacecraft asteroid explorers to explore different types of asteroids, and then in the last step to try a predictive impact, so based on the outcome of DART and HERA, to send essentially a rendezvous spacecraft to an asteroid, and based on the properties of this asteroid to predict the beta for a second impact on that object. Now, it's difficult to, for me at least, difficult to predict to how deep we will be, how to which accuracy we will be able to do this prediction. But at least I would think that we will be with that and here and with further missions, we will be able to improve this understanding from what we have now, where the impact efficiency can essentially be anywhere between 1 and 3 or 4. So that we at least will be able to get to fix some range, and also maybe some range related to asteroid properties or asteroid taxonomy type.
Okay. Thank you. This was the last question in the chat box. The time is over. 1 hour, and I thank you again, Michael, for this talk and all your answers. Wish you good luck for the HERA mission. Laura, do you yes. have any concluding remarks?
Yes. Thank you very much, Professor Küppers, for the outstanding talk. It went a bit longer than usual, but it was really good, and the questions were very insightful. So thank you very much. And as usual, we will publish the recording tomorrow or the day after. So for those who missed it, I would like to remind the ones who are those who are still online that we will have a short break here at ESA Beijing, and we will be back on the 25th of August with a talk on Galfan 5 of the Chinese Academy of Sciences, and the talk will be given by Li Zhenqiang. So hope to see you there, and wish you a good summer. Thank you very much once again, Professor Kurt and Professor Küppers.
Thank you very much for the invitation and for the very nice moderation.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.